Yo.
Yo.
Yeah, live on the seaside with your boy Mulga.
What up?
But I fell in love on the seaside. Yeah. Damn. All right. What up, Seasiders? What up, Motorinos? And welcome to the Seaside Show. We're on the desk here. We're live with Mulga the Artist, Joel Moore. What's happening, my man?
How's it going, Clary? I'm just painting some canvases while we chat.
Oh, no, I love that.
Efficient.
That's what we do, mate. Two birds, one stone, all that good stuff. On the hustle, dog.
Yeah, I love that. Killing two birds with one stone.
Oh, mate. Metaphorically speaking, always. We were saying earlier when I had a bit of a hiccup, my intro, which you can't hear, I'm still trying to sort that out so y'all can hear my intro when I do these ones via Zoom, but the recording, Joel and I did some recording back many, many years ago. Joel is a cousin of mine. And yeah, I think my voice has gotten a lot deeper. I don't know if it's as sweet as it once was, but I don't know. It all started from somewhere, man, and here we are.
Yeah, that was a great recording session. The talent out of nowhere.
Oh, mate. Unexpected. Maybe we'll release it. Maybe we won't. I don't know. But Mulga the Artist, he's a street artist. And he's been on the rise for the last few years. But what's been happening with you, my man?
Lately, I've just been kind of locked down. I've got lots of mural jobs that I can't do at the moment. Lots of ones at schools and out of area. So I've just been working at home, painting these three canvases at the moment for Furphy.
Yep.
Some people won them when they bought some beer. That's what I'm doing right now. But yeah, it's been doing lots of surfing, trying to homeschool the kids.
Yeah, nice. How's that all going, the homeschooling, dude? How does one homeschool three kids and paint all your paintings, family? Oh, I can only imagine it would be a bit of a shit fight.
Sarah, my wife, is quite capable. So she she does a lot of the heavy lifting. Yeah, so like my daughter's 12, she does her own homeschooling.
Yeah.
She's quite conscientious. And then we got two younger boys. And Sarah does the 7-year-old and I do Frankie. Yeah, they're not into the schooling at all.
No way. Yeah, I can see you got a nice little Westie tan there on the neck, the Weddy tan. Love that.
Oh, is that?
Yeah, on the back of your neck. You might not see it under your beard, but we're getting a bit of an action on it. Joel's actually, if you can't see it, he's painting some. What are you doing? Some murals? Ooh, canvases for Furphy?
Yeah, so they had some in-store promotions where you buy a case of beer and you could win a painting of that I did of like you and your friends as spirit animals.
Mm-hmm.
So like we got one here. It's going to be a cockatoo, kookaburra, emu, and a butterfly. That's four buddies. We got someone here who wanted me to paint their beagle. And then we got two wombats here holding a Furphy Esky, and they've got their four pets down the bottom. So yeah,
nice.
I'll eventually post the finished pics on my Instagram sometime in the future.
Okay, well, we look forward to seeing them, dude. On that note, how have you changed? Now, we're obviously in the midst of a lockdown, been in it for a while. Not our first one as well, but how have you found the change from what you would usually do, big kind of street murals, obviously in schools, all that jazz. How have you had to shift and change?
Yeah, so a lot of my murals that I had booked in were at schools and out of area, so they're just on hold. For me, the lockdown's actually been like pretty good. It's been a chance to get like smaller stuff done home. So actually before lockdown, I was actually thinking like, how am I going to do all these murals plus all these other jobs that I've committed to, like smaller, like painting these canvases? Like this is already late. I was meant to have this delivered a while ago. So it's kind of been a good chance for me to catch up.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I'm pretty fortunate. You know, everyone's affected. Like, I guess there's a lot of future jobs that potential jobs that just aren't happening. Haven't really got many inquiries lately. So
it is what it is. Yeah. Did you ever kind of sit down and knuckle down on some just actual, are you only painting jobs for other people, or can you start say, look at it and go, I'm going to start knuckling down and do some more canvases and try and flog them, or is that not worth your hustle and time?
Yeah, I haven't done that for a while. Mostly I'm just doing, you know, commission works.
Yeah.
So I'll get an email, like Furphy sends me an email and we chat about it. So I just, yeah, most of my stuff is for like clients, customers. Yep. Yeah, I don't really ever do any artworks for myself. Been thinking about that, taking on less commission work and maybe, you know, doing some, I guess, making, you know, taking steps to take control of my art career instead of just doing whatever pops into my inbox.
Yeah, instead of being responsive.
But then you get, just kind of be more intentional about where I want to go and what I want to do. But you get really, you get fun jobs popping in the inbox and good pay.
Yeah,
so you're
like, yeah, good pay. And yeah, I suppose you just keep rolling with it. But I suppose it's a good way to kind of, at least you got your thinking cap on and kind of where you might need to go and start, yeah, kind of paving your own path there, even though you're still obviously doing it all yourself, but thinking maybe, yeah, longer term or something like that. But that's kind of cool, yeah. And how, I suppose, let's go for a little wind back for everyone, because I don't know, how long you've been painting for, Joel? Like, how long have you been Mulga the Artist for? And it's been quite a rise as well. I mean, you've got some good credibility from other artists in the community who I've spoken with as well. Where did it all begin for you?
It was 2012 is when I kind of became Mulga the Artist, kind of launched my career, had an art show in a little gallery in Cronulla. But probably two years before that, I kind of started doing, I was always drawing and sketching all like since leaving high school. I went and studied economics at uni. But I was always sketching in lectures, like just drawing doodles, you know, nothing serious, just always doodling. And then I had a job, got a job in financial planning. So I worked in financial planning for 10 years, but again, always doodling and drawing when I should have been working. Nothing worse than getting caught drawing when you should be working. It's the worst.
What did the bosses say to you, dude?
I actually installed a mirror. One of those little mirrors you put on your side mirror on your car, those circular ones, so I could see if my boss was sneaking up on me.
So you were in that for 10 years. At what point did you kind of just realize, like, I don't want to be doing this? Or was it like, was there a crossover between when the art started and you're doing your work? Or was there just like a moment where you're like, I'm going to do a bit more art? Like, what was the mental process behind that?
Yeah, so yeah, I was working in the financial planning for 10 years and I was just kind of stuck in the same role. Like I was a paraplanner, and a paraplanner prepares the documents. So the financial planner meets with the client, thinks of the strategy, then they give the file to me, and then I got to put it together in a 100-page Word document with the investments in there and graphs projecting how their money's going to grow. So I was just kind of like a back office dude. And then the next step, I guess, would be become a financial planner, but I just couldn't bring myself to do it. Couldn't be professional having to talk to old people. I had no desire to do that. And I was getting pretty frustrated just staying in that same low paid job.
Yeah.
And I just did not want to do that for the rest of my life. I was actually reading lots of books. You know, there's a million books on like doing what you want. Doing what you love for a job and reading biographies, just kind of slowly getting inspired. And then, yeah, I was doodling and drawing for that whole time. So what I did is I got my brother, Kieran.
Yeah.
He's a photographer. Got him to take photos of my doodles and sketches. And then I just put them on the internet, Google Blogspot, still up there actually, mulgasroom.blogspot. And you can see if you go to my first post on there, it's like, it's like six little post-it notes that I did at work. Those little yellow post-it notes. Yeah, random squiggles on there. That's how I started. So I just started putting my art on there. Then I would draw at nighttime while I was watching telly.
Yeah.
And being a bit more intentional about my art, thinking about what I'm going to draw. Just doing random stuff. And then, a friend of a friend. One of my friends kind of recommended me to this gallery in Cronulla. Just run by some surfers, pretty casual kind of art gallery. And we had an art show there in February 2012. And my other brother, Eden, is an artist. He had an art show there together. And he had his art up there as well. And that was kind of my launch into
you start there. The I remember there was a bit of live music. You're selling some t-shirts and stuff.
Yep.
It was a pretty cool little afternoon.
Yeah, I was mad. The cops came in the end and shut it down. So Dogs. It was obviously a good party.
Yeah, which is what we love, man. Yeah, how important do you think it is, say, like starting your doodling and just is like when you're starting that doodling on the post-it notes and you're getting photos taken and you don't realize how rookie it is at the time, because I probably started in like a similar way, but you're just doing it. Is that just kind of that first, do you think it's like that first step of just moving forward is just making a step, even if it's not that amazing?
Yeah, totally. And then putting it out there, even if it's rubbish, if you start an Instagram account and your artwork's, you know, you're just still experimenting, like no one's going to see it anyway. So nothing to be embarrassed about. Yeah, just doing the first step. Do it, draw something, and then share it with the world. Who knows what will happen?
Yeah. And so let's even wind it back a bit further, dude. So were you always a painter, always an artist? I remember your drawings were quite good when we were young. Any inspirations for you? Any big plans, dreams to be an artist?
All through school, I was always interested in drawing, just doodling, you know, Bart Simpson characters and muscle men. They weren't really that good. I wasn't really a very good artist or anything. And yeah, in high school, in art class, it's quite popular in art class. I was kind of a chubby, shy kid at school, but in art class, I was like a chick magnet for some reason. It was pretty funny.
Just the arts, man. You're that true, cool art guy that just is like quiet. It's mysterious. We want to know what's about him.
Yeah, the chick started noticing me when in art, because I do a drawing and it must have looked all right. I'm like, oh, you're pretty good.
Let's be honest. That's where it all started, dog.
I love the act of creating, you know, creating music. I love doing that. Creating, you know, you start off with a blank piece of paper and then you think of something and you get yourself a Posca and you draw it and looks pretty cool. And then you can put it on a t-shirt and sell it and have a business and support yourself and people can enjoy the art and wear the t-shirt and makes them smile.
Yeah, it's cool, man.
Created that all from nothing, yeah.
Mate, 100%. Now you are big on your music. Was that ever an option for you? Do you think your love for music and art like are somewhat, they grow together? Do they correlate?
Yeah, I thought about being a musician, but I knew it was very, very hard career path. Like, I think being a musician is like way harder than being a visual artist.
Why do you think that? I think if you looked at them left like next to each other, you'd be like, oh, you're just going to sell paintings. I suppose that was just one direction of art that we probably never really thought about potentially before, say, Instagram or something like that.
Yeah, but if you think about musicians, how do they make money? They make money by getting some Spotify money live, which is so hard. If you want to play live music, you got to go around lugging all your gear at nighttime. Not good if you have a family. No. And then they probably make most of their money from merch. Yeah. And you know what merch is? That is artworks on a t-shirt. So in the end, they make most of their money from art. Plus, I didn't think I was good enough anyway.
Yeah. No.
That too.
How much? Yeah. Yeah. And no, I guess I'm not like Jimi Hendrix. How much thought process was it behind when you were starting all your art? Was it like this big, did you have a big plan or was it just kind of, well, from what you've told me from your hustle, from when it started, you started at markets. Can you walk us through a bit of those early days when Mulga was becoming a thing?
Yeah. So I was working in my day job and I wanted to get out of that. What I really wanted was a job that I liked or loved, and I definitely didn't love my job. Like, you meet people and I'd ask them, oh, do you like your job? They're like, yeah, I love it. I'm like, damn, I want to love my job. So I knew I didn't love my job, so I had to make my own job I love, because I couldn't think of anything else. Kind of like drawing, so I tried. So I had to figure out, how am I going to turn drawing into my job? And the main part of the job is making money.
Yes.
So I'm like, how can I make money from my art? So my plan was just put my art on t-shirts, go to the markets and sell them. That was my whole business plan.
Did you think
I started that in 2012.
Yeah. Did you think much about a business plan, or was it more just a lot of just let's get the ball rolling, let's do and see what could happen?
No, that was my business plan. Literally make a cool artwork that'll be good on a t-shirt, go get it printed, get 100 of them printed, go to the markets, buy a gazebo, buy some racks, super low investment. That's why I was so good.
It is.
And if it failed, you haven't really wasted much money. It's not like you've set up a restaurant and spend $300,000 fitting it out and all that.
Yeah.
And I think I knew what looked good on a t-shirt. It's like pretty, you know, if you have really good art that looks good on t-shirts and, you know, you understand the market, who's buying them, how much they're willing to pay.
Yeah.
I read lots of business books and marketing books and books about entrepreneurs. So
any of those books?
Yeah, it worked out.
Any of those books that you could recommend to us that really sparked or kind of triggered into your growth or the start of your hustle?
It's funny. I read heaps of books and I just kind of forget most of them and don't really do what they say. Remember Gary Vaynerchuk had a good one. What was it? Crush It. He's like a business guru guy.
Yeah, I started listening to him a few years ago. Read Crush It?
Yeah, I read Crush It. That was pretty cool. Just about, you know, kind of went through his story and he just talked about, you know, building your personal brand, you know, making content, getting yourself out there.
Mm.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. Yes. It is. Yeah, it's pretty wild how it all worked. Now, how much of your growth kind of was helped off the back of Instagram? Now, I'm trying to think when it even really started. Did you do the markets before Insta and stuff like that?
Yeah, I remember I was in my day job and I didn't get on Instagram straight away. I remember a young guy at my job had Instagram. He's like, you should get on Instagram. So I did. And then, it must have been around the time when I started doing the markets. But, yeah, I think Instagram was, like, really massive help because I just, you know, you put all your art up there. It's pretty much made for
For what you're doing, artists. Hey.
Yeah, it was just images. Now it's more videos and stuff, but back then it was just images.
Yeah.
So I'd like post on Instagram, I'm going to be at Bondi Markets, you know, tomorrow. And then people would come and they say, yeah, I came from like Western Sydney to, I saw your Instagram post, and they come and they spend money. So it literally translated into money.
Yeah, that's good, man.
So yeah, Instagram was huge. Like being an artist before social media and all this, so hard. How do you do it?
I don't know. Yeah. It's a bit, huge question but then even now it's so saturated as well, and even it's harder to get kind of grow on Instagram at the moment, so you got in at a good time as well, Jolly Boy. Mate, for those early stages of the hustle, now did you work and then you were kind of, I think you had like a, you were going to do like a day, take a day off a week for your work until it got to a point where you actually jumped right into the deep end and were like, all right, I'm going to make this my job?
Yeah, so 2012, had my first art show, started doing the markets, and then I ended up 2014, like 2 years later is when I quit my day job completely. But like maybe, I don't know, 6 months or something before, I went down to 1 day a week. And then I was thinking of doing taking off 2 days a week from my day job, and I'm like, stuff it, let's just throw it in.
Yeah.
So I did some calculations and I figured out how much, you know, I needed to make at the markets to like kind of replace my income. And it was kind of achievable as long as it didn't rain every weekend. And you can ramp it up. You know, when I was working, I would do Bondi markets on a Sunday, maybe occasionally do something on a Saturday, and then back at work. It was like, it's a hard slog for 2 years. I kind of had two jobs for 2 years, but
yeah, man.
I just kind of, I was busy. I remember I had an art show, like a group art show at Bondi Pavilion. And I was doing these big paintings, and then I remember just being like not having enough time and being stressed, and then like people want to have a meeting with you at 11 a.m. on a Tuesday. I'm like, yeah, I've got a job.
Yeah.
So
it was just like a bit of a tap on your shoulder, being like, bro, let's get out of here, and kind of give yourself that flexibility. Hey, if you're gonna
just kind of it took the leap. What helped was that we had a little bit of. Like we sold a unit we lived in and we're renting, so we had a little bit of money in the bank, which kind of helped.
Just gives hugely. You that buffer.
You know, be able to buy t-shirts. Yeah, have that buffer. Yeah. That cash buffer. Yeah, that was like huge to have that.
And how scary was that point when you were like, oh, let's go all in here? Because I suppose so many people are doing the hustle these days, or I suppose because of all the information out there and good information, good stories, like so many people are grinding in these jobs being like, why am I doing this? So there is always people looking for a hustle. But then actually building it up while you're working another job is the hard bit. And then getting to that point where you're like, all right, I'm going to go all in here is also even the more courageous bit. How hard was that for you? Or how exciting?
Yeah, it wasn't. I didn't find it scary. Maybe just because I didn't think about it much. But basically, I just did my little calculations, you know, how much I needed to. Maybe I did, you know, calculated I do 26 markets a year. I've got to make this amount of profit to kind of replace my income. Mm. That's kind of, I just did these little calculations. And I'm like, yeah, it shouldn't be too hard.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, you get all these other jobs, you know, stuff starts happening. You get commissioned, you do live art events, and you get all these other, make money in other ways that you don't know. So now I don't even do markets at all.
Nah. Beyond that, because that's a lot of time for you there, just being down there. Hey, but and you've got a big online store, which is growing pretty strongly as well.
Yeah. The future's, you know, online. It's so much easier. You don't have to go doing markets. As you know, you've done markets.
Yeah.
It's hard slog. It is stressing about the weather. Oh. You got to lug all your stuff down there.
Oh mate. Dude.
All day, yeah. There.
I'll be doing it after a footy. Like, I'd play footy on Saturday, probably have beer Saturday night, and then I'm just there Sunday, like, damn it.
Yeah, it's not fun.
All right, we're going to go into a quick fast five, dude. Now, these are five questions. I'm going to give you kind of two options, and then you're just going to hit us back with one or the other, bro. Cool.
Sweet. Sounds easy.
It is. All right. Big murals or small murals?
Small. I do mostly small. I kind of like to get in and out.
Yeah.
The big ones are kind of better. If you do a big, huge public mural on a building, it's like good for your profile, but I'm quite lazy. It just takes too long. I'm just like, I've done big ones and I'm just like, when will this end? I just want to move on to the next one.
Yeah. Is it a lot like that for your work? Is it kind of like, it just, is it more enjoyable just pumping them out as opposed to like 2 weeks on something?
Yeah, I guess because I'm fortunate enough to have a lot of work lined up. Mm. It becomes my just trying to do it as fast as possible. So it's not really, does it become enjoyable when you're trying to like smash a 3-day mural out in 2 days? I've actually been thinking a lot about slowing down and, you know, doing a 3-day mural in 3 days instead of 2 days. Maybe go for a surf here and there while I'm doing the mural.
Enjoy just yourself, Joel. Life more. Yeah. I think the wisdom kicking through, which is what we'll jump into, but we'll keep moving on the fast five. Acoustic guitar or electric guitar?
Oh, I like acoustic just because it's just sitting there on the lounge and I can just pick it up and have a strum.
Yeah.
But electric, if you want to like rock out.
Yeah. So which one, bro?
Acoustic.
Okay, nice. System of a Down or Korn?
System of a Down for sure.
Yeah.
Love that Toxicity album. So good.
I know, you guys got me on.
Korn's good too, though.
Yeah. you got me into them heavy, bro. I love them so much. A point break or a beach break?
Point. Especially if you can walk around instead of paddling back out, like Bally Point.
Yeah.
Paddling's hard work, man.
Paddling is hard work, dude. It is. All right, last one. And painting or Posca's?
Posca's. I do Posca's on smaller paper artworks, paint, house paint on canvases or bigger. I'll say Posca. You chill at home while I'm doing it.
All right, so now we go into the rise of Mulga, dude. You've established some, like, you know, a pretty solid online presence. You're already doing some really cool jobs. What kind of changed for you as you started making some big momentum, or how did things change along the way?
You just kind of do one job and it kind of leads to another. Yeah, and someone sees you, like, painting down at Bondi on the promenade there. It's always been something that I want to have an artwork down there because I think it's really good on a promotion for yourself. Lots of people that walk down there and live there are like working in the the advertising industry. So they're a lot of my, I'll get an email, it'll be like from an agency, an ad agency that works for like a big brand. So they're the kind of the best emails you want to get.
Because they're the ones
brand stuff is kind of,
they're the ones linking you guys
together.
Yeah,
they're the ones that recommend me. Mm. Yeah, so I just painted at Audi at North Sydney, and you know, there was a design agency recommend me for that. The guy that works, that I liaised with, he was like an artist himself. He knew of my art. Not sure how, but yeah, just murals are a great way to get your name out there. So doing public murals is good business.
Like once you started getting a bit of a ball roll on, were you doing more murals then sort of thing than you are now?
No, I'm doing more murals now. Just, I guess, as people get to know you, discover your art and like it, and then, you know, if they follow you on social media, if they see you doing lots of murals, then they're going to ask you to do a mural. Basically, whatever you put out there is what you're going to get come back to you. But, it just grows as more people get to know you, you get more opportunities. I've never really pursued work or advertise or anything. It's just kind of, you do your work, announce it on Instagram or whatever.
I suppose, and then you're just showing what you can kind of get up to, what your product is, what your options are for anyone out there. Now, we did a bit of
that being said, like in the early days, I kind of did, hustle and try and get my art in art shows and apply for jobs with councils. But then you kind of get to a stage, where it kind of just snowballs. It kind of just kind of have this momentum.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's good.
Because I remember, we went and saw you painting at like Newtown at the Beach Burrito. And you did a mural there, and I remember you saying like, "Look, it's not great money, but it's a big mural somewhere like where I want it to be or something." And were you just kind of in a mentality of just take on jobs, even if the cash isn't amazing?
Yeah, say yes to everything. Say yes to everything, especially when you're starting out. Like, how valuable is your time?
Yeah,
if you're just sitting at home and you're watching telly, then your time's worth zero. So you might as well do everything you can to get your name out there and hustle. And then when you become busier, then you have to increase your prices, because otherwise there's not enough time to do everything.
And your time is worth it, bro. Now, my friend Sam Hall, who you've kind of worked with, we worked on Drip by Drip together. Mate, he says you're an absolute machine when it comes to pumping out murals. Is there a secret to it, Joel?
I guess you just kind of... you just stick to what you know. So you just, there's a certain way I paint, and there's a certain subject matter I paint, and then you just kind of refine that and get efficient at it. I have lots of volunteers help me paint. That's really cool. Like people that want to maybe figure out how to paint murals themselves, or, emerging artists, or people want to meet me, ask questions. I'm like, we can hang out next time I'm painting a mural. I'll send you a message and you can come along and have a paint with me. So
it's pretty, I've done it a few times and it's pretty enjoyable. Like, I don't know. It's kind of nice. You just slap and paint on and you can have a chat. It's pretty, pretty cruisy stuff.
Yeah, super casual. Everyone's having a great time. It's just super relaxing. No responsibility.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone loves love it. That, bro. How do you find yourself managing your jobs as you kind of get more busy, going from like these kind of small ones to then just like big ones and then slotting them all in between? I remember chatting to Sam and he says it's just kind of can be a headache as well.
Yeah, just use Google Calendar. And it's hard. People are like, you got time to do this one? I'm like, sure.
Yeah. you just jump into it.
You say yes to everything and then, you can actually work a lot. I could work a heap harder than I am. You could sleep 6 hours a night, not watch Netflix, and you could like work heaps harder if you really have to, not that you want to.
Yeah.
But so you could sleep less if you have sleep less if you have heaps of jobs and you've overcommitted. But now I just try and say no a lot more. Yeah,
that's good. You got a value on yourself, which I like, dude. Which I like. You mentioned the weather as well, man. Like, how frightening is the weather for you, especially when you've got big mural jobs?
Yeah, painting outside murals can be hard with the weather and annoying. But it hasn't been a major issue. Sometimes I like chuck a tarp up. Once I was painting painting at Liverpool, and we had like a boom lift, and then we chucked the tarp on the roof, put some weights on it, and then like flopped it over the boom, and we're just under there in the dark painting. So you can actually get a lot done if you get a huge tarp.
Okay.
I've done that quite a few times. Well, just get a tarp out, smash it.
Now, if you're doing some big one where you're on a big scissor lift, what I generally, for the listeners at home, how do you do it? How do you turn a painting from like what is on your phone or whatever, then putting it on this big 20 meter wall?
Yeah, so a lot of artists do this technique, though. I don't know if it's called. You basically just, you can spray paint all random markings on the wall, like all random markings, like a grid. What I do is I put random bits of sticky tape, like blue masking tape, all over the wall. Then I'll stand back and you get a photo straight on. And then I've got an app on my phone, like Photoshop Mix app. And you just overlay your sketch on top of the photo of the wall, and you make your sketch like 50% see-through. So then you can see where each sketch line relates to each of these individual bits of masking tape, which are all different. And then you kind of just do a dot to dot thing. So if you see any big mural, that's how the artist has done it. Most of them just use spray. I don't use spray paint, but they'll just mark spray paint. I know Sam Hall, he does that.
Yeah.
Just mark spray paint. Yeah. And then you can get it perfect. Such a good tip. Such a good trick to use as a muralist.
It is cool. Yeah. Cause I remember asking my boy, what's with all of those? And he's like, yeah, it's where you kind of, now it gives you like a scale, or like lets you know where you are on the mural, I guess.
Yeah. The first mural I painted was down at Bondi Beach. It was like a gorilla, super simple one, like a gorilla was coming out and he was holding an ice cream in his hand.
Yeah.
I didn't know that technique back then.
Yeah.
So I was, took me ages just to sketch it up. Like the head literally was just like a round thing coming out of the ground. It was like super easy to draw, but it took me ages to sketch it up. Looking back, oh no.
Yeah.
I hated sketching. It was so hard until I figured out this technique. But before I did this technique, I was gridding. So I'd like make a grid on the sketch, and then you have to draw the grid lines. Oh, it was a nightmare.
I get remember the measurements Mr. Mubs did that at Drip by drip, he's like, yeah, man, I'm old school, man. And he's just got his little grid paper and he's just doing it. But he was a bit of an interesting fella as well.
Yeah, sometimes you have to do a grid. Like if you paint a round column, you got to do a grid because you can't get a photo of the whole thing at once.
So you got to be adaptable.
I guess you could if you had some kind of 360 camera.
A fisheye. Yeah. Mate, and how have you seen Mulga evolved along the way? Can you see it evolving further?
Like my artwork, like just my style of my art is always changing. I'm always trying to get better. Just in the last couple of years, I've started doing like tonal. Like when I started, I was doing like patterns.
Yeah.
Like heaps of patterns. Like I've got an owl and it's just like one owl and then super heaps of patterns and then all black lines in between. And now I don't really do those so much. It's more, shading.
Yeah.
Like tonal, like if you look at this, I don't know if you can see, but like every one of those colors, like this orange, I do a light orange and then I do the dark orange.
Yeah.
See the light green, the dark green.
Yeah.
That kind of tonal, less about patterns and more about just doing some shading or whatever.
Yeah.
So that means I can draw anything now. When I started, all I could draw was like a bearded head or a gorilla head. So if I had a wall to paint on and it wasn't like portrait mode, you know, like an A4 piece of paper portrait, I'm like, how am I going to draw it?
What are you going to fill in on it?
Yeah, well, I don't know what to do. Do I do like 10 bearded heads on this long skinny wall? It was like years. I was just like freaking about that. But now this new style, you can kind of draw anything. So if you want to draw a bunch of characters at a beach scene. So it works really well for advertising as well, for like brand collaborations and stuff like that.
Because you've got to be adaptable, hey?
Yeah. Yeah.
You started out with the beards. What was with the beards? You yourself are a big beard lover. What was with the beards and what's your philosophy behind beards?
Oh, beards are sweet. They're like magical. I mean, I started drawing bearded characters. I think I like the idea of a bearded character as a t-shirt. Like you just put it on the front of a t-shirt. Bearded character looks so sweet. And then like a gorilla head, that's kind of like a big beard all around its head, 360 degree beard. But beards are just, I don't know, just working in the day job for 10 years, you're not allowed to, you're not meant to have a beard. You need to look all clean shaven. So every time it would be like holidays, summer holidays or whatever, I just like grow the beard out, give myself a crazy haircut, Christmas haircut, I used to call it.
Get a mullet or a mohawk. Hey.
But now I just do a Christmas haircut all year. I kind of have a mohawk. It's kind of grown out a bit.
Nice,
it's kind of my signature look, personal branding.
Yeah, you got to rock it, dude, and the beard. It's good. You understand it.
Yeah, plus shaving sucks. Who likes shaving? The worst.
Nah. I've just started my shaving.
Not be bothered.
Back into it. Not really. Pinterest are pretty easy, to be honest. So.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Can you see yourself venturing out of the art you're doing and like trying anything new, going down a different avenue at all?
No, I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing, but then you can make slight adjustments, new directions. I'd like to get back into my music. You know, doesn't have to be big. You just put some songs on Spotify.
Yeah.
And then maybe you play some gigs and you play a festival. Who knows?
Sure. Who knows? Next minute, we got a million followers. I'd back you, bro. I'd back you. So that kind of ties into Mulga. Where did Mulga start? And you had a bit of a band with Mulga's Room as well?
Yeah, well, I got my nickname Mulga at school. When I was in year five, one of my classmates said, I actually recited a poem, Mulga Bill's Bicycle by Banjo Patterson. And one of my classmates was trying to hassle me. He's like, it's Mulga. And that became my nickname after that. So that's kind of why I use go the name Mulga.
Cheers, bro. And Mulga, and poem writing, it was very big part of the start of your kind of big growth on Instagram. You do a post and there'd be a poem to every post, wasn't there?
Yeah, so I guess I take a lot of time to do a good artwork, and then when I come to write the poem or the story, I just kind of whip it out, just whatever pops into my head, just try and make it weird and funny. Just like making people laugh. So if I can make someone have a little chuckle about it, that's a win. And I get that's a good way to just add a bit more depth to the art, make it stand out. Makes it, you can write something funny.
Bit of differentiation there, brother.
Yeah,
in
exactly.
NBA became a bit of an effort as well, no doubt.
Yeah, well, I actually started out doing poems that like rhyme, but now I don't do that at all. It's way too hard trying to make a poem that rhymes and then have it make sense. It's a flipping nightmare. So now I just write a story. It doesn't rhyme. So my poems I called like, say, it was like a gorilla, like Featherbone the Brave. It'd be like an ode, Featherbone the Brave. But now they're all the story of Beard and Bruce or whatever. Still hard. I've actually got heaps of like artworks I've done that I need to like, you know, share on the socials, but I still got to write a story for them. So I go to do a post. I'm like, oh, I've got to write the story. I couldn't be bothered.
and look, you've got standards. You don't want to do like a super crap one. So there's kind of like that natural pressure from yourself to like just make sure it's somewhat good enough, hey? Or someone on brand for yourself.
At the moment, I kind of like doing one. Like it might be about I did a portrait of someone's dog. And then I'll write about the dog, how he likes surfing. But then I'll just like introduce this random character that's not in the picture at all. And then I'll just start talking about that character and its story. It's got nothing to do with the picture. Kind of like doing that, just kind of going off on a tangent. And then usually when I get sick of writing the story, I just write the end. I don't wind it up properly. I'm like, oh, that's good enough, the end.
Yeah. And then he made it to the top of the mountain, the end.
And I like writing like a little kid, like it was heaps good. And like sometimes my sentences don't have any dot, like stop. Whatever you call it, the bit that ends the sentence, it's just like keeps going on and on.
Yeah.
Like a 10 line sentence. I just love making just dodgy writing. It's great.
Well, you're being authentic, bro. You can kind of do what you want. How important do you think it is at continuing writing your poems for your bits of art? Is there a bit where you're like, oh, I don't really need to do that. Who cares? Or is it a bit like, I want to stick true to myself and what I've done and I've done to get here? Is there any of that in there?
No, I think I'll always write the stories just because I do like doing it. It is hard work, but anything worth doing is hard work.
Yeah.
It's just a bit of effort. But Yeah, it's just another way to create and just make a magical world. And it's, yeah, I don't put a lot of thought on it in it or put a lot of pressure on myself. I just like take time to do a good drawing, and then the story, I just like whack it out as fast as I can, whatever pops into my head. Some of them are weirder and funnier than others. So I just kind of want to make it super weird, random, funny. And then one day I want to release a book which has like, you know, there's a picture and here's a story.
Yeah.
Like a coffee table book or something.
I reckon that'd be pretty good. Just some light reading, yeah. Bro. I like that. I like that.
Yeah, and you can read it to your kid at bedtime. You just like read one story.
Yeah.
Great.
Mate, now, yeah, as we kind of alluded to earlier, we did a bit of the drip-by-drip stuff together. No doubt you've done a lot of street art in the past, or like kind of street art events, rather. How important do you think they are for yourself to do, and how important do you think they are for, like, the art community and the community that you're kind of painting for as well?
Yeah, I think it's super important. Like, we painted that basketball court, and before you got there with your drip by drip event, it was just, you know, there's no art. It was just kind of graffiti, kind of had downer vibes in the area. So putting some real cool art on there and having a cool event for the community, I think it's awesome. Adds culture and makes place friendlier and people meet each other. Yeah, I think it's great. Should be heaps more of it.
It should. Now, you've done a bit of Mulga and the Artist in Japan. What's the venture towards that? What was that whole process?
Yeah, so I have like an agent in Japan, or like someone who's representing my art in Japan. So they work primarily in licensing my art. So they're trying to, you know, maybe they sign up with a company that makes phone cases and put my art on phone cases, and then that company will sell them and they pay us a royalty. So that's basically just licensing. So I've been with them for like a while. I don't know how long. Could be like 6 years.
Mm.
Yeah, actually, a lady from Japan was visiting Bondi. She bought an elephant T-shirt at Bondi Markets, and then she went back to Japan. And her friend was Shima, who's my agent in Japan. And Shima saw this elephant T-shirt and liked the art. And she was just leaving her job in a licensing business to start her own licensing company with her sister. And then I thought, oh, this guy's a pretty good artist. Sends me an email. We have a chat. She asks if she could represent me. I'm like, yeah, sweet. And then she flew over from Japan to Sydney. Like, they do things properly.
Yeah. They don't like, there's no Zoom calls. No. This is in-person stuff.
Yeah, it's exactly opposite to me. I'm like, half the jobs I do, mural jobs, I will never go and look at the wall. I just like, send me a photo. I don't want to talk to you on the phone. Just send me an email, photo. The biggest ever job, mural job I did, I'd never been there in person. I rocked up and went, holy crap, this wall is huge.
Did that ever bite you on the ass, dude?
No, that one was good. I actually overquoted for that, so that worked out well. Sometimes they do, yeah. You're like, shivers, these bricks are like really hard to paint on. I'm going to be here for twice as long as I thought. You just got to chop it up.
I really should have checked out that wall. God damn it.
Yeah, you just have to like make it a learning experience and try not to repeat the mistake. That's all you can say to yourself in those situations.
Yeah, I'm big on that. Like, it's all right to make a mistake as long as you don't make the same mistake twice.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes, yeah, you stuff up, things go wrong. The only positive is learning from it. That's the only positive sometimes.
Yeah. You just go, just a lesson. I will be better for next time.
But back to Japan. So I've usually been going over there once a year and we'll do a mural or do an event in a shop. So yeah, I've actually, I love working with the crew over there, and they're really busy doing lots of cool stuff. And hopefully we can get big in Japan.
Good way to scale your art as well, in the term of like, how can you evolve or like plan for the future? That's a pretty good way. Like, they kind of do the heavy lifting and you just get the royalties, right?
Yeah. Licensing is kind of what I really want to focus a lot more on. It's basically a lot of the time we're licensing existing artworks. So I've got a huge catalog of artworks that I retain my like intellectual property rights for.
Mm.
And so she can just share that with people that want to license, and they go, yeah, we'll use these ones. So it's pretty cool. You got this artworks. Most of them are already being paid to do for some other project or as an original artwork. And then So every time I do an artwork, I'm like double dipping. Like these artworks, I'll take a photo of them. I'll retain the copyright, and then I can turn them into prints, art prints, and sell them. Put them on a jigsaw puzzle.
Yeah.
Love double dipping. It's the best.
Wait, so, man, yeah, licensing. Two birds, one stone.
Yeah. Licensing is kind of like the passive income.
Yeah.
So painting murals is like super hard work, and like it's like a job.
Yeah.
But if you can license your art and they print it on a t-shirt, they sell 50 million t-shirts and you're getting 5 cents per t-shirt, you can make a lot of money if you get like some good big deals.
Well, Japan seems on brand for you, quite colorful, quite out there.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. So yeah, I've got, hopefully can really take off. It's going pretty good, but not major. I'm not like I'm famous or anything.
We'll get there, bro. Baby steps, dog. Baby steps. Now, what do you love about, what do you love about your job for, I don't know, anyone aspiring out there to get on that hustle game? What's the good bits about it for you, man?
I just like being my own boss, keeping my own hours, taking on the work I want to take on. Like, I've got a pretty good job. I draw pictures and get paid to do it. Like, I'm literally drawing pictures. I'm drawing these dumb pictures of animals wearing sunglasses. This is my job. Making pretty good money doing it.
And you're totally serious right now. It's 100% true. And it's so gone.
But, you know, I'm adding value.
Yeah.
People value it. So,
mate, you made some sacrifice along the way. And look, I think any artist, how about this, Joel? Obviously, there's so many good artists out there, you know? Like, there's a wealth of good art. What's the difference between someone being a good artist, drawing cool stuff, and someone in your position earning some good money, but like with a family and sustaining your family with the job like this? What do you think separates from just good art?
Yeah. Well, I guess what's your intention? So if your intention is to make an artwork and express your feelings, then you'll probably do that. But if you haven't thought about how you can translate that into money, then you're probably not going to make money. So if your intention is to make an artwork and express how you feel, you'll do it, but you might not be able to sell it. But if your intention is to make an artwork and then put it on a t-shirt, go to the markets and sell the t-shirt, then you're a lot more likely to make money. So I guess just coming from a business perspective, thinking about who wants to buy the artwork, how it's going to apply in the real world. You know, does someone want to pay that money for the artwork? How big the market is? It's like, you know, it's just a product, really.
Yeah.
So 100%. It's like starting a business. You just got to think like a business person, and it actually makes you do better art
because you're more direct with what you're trying to do. Hey.
Yeah, if you want, it's really hard to get people to give you money. You know, starting a business, you got to do something good.
Yeah.
So it actually makes you do better art. If you express yourself, you can do anything because you don't have to try and sell it. But if you're trying to sell it, put the art on a t-shirt and get people to buy it, it's got to look good. Yeah. T-shirt's got to be nice. You got to do a really good job.
Yeah, you get a bit more of a direct thought about how you're going to do it, why you're going to do it, who's it's going to be for.
Give yourself attention.
A bit of clarity, a bit of purpose or direction. How do you find balancing between, you know, putting your business cap on and then just being creative? Or does it just kind of like you got your business cap on, you make the business decision first, and then you just go and paint something epic that comes into your brain?
It can be hard juggling between the two. Like doing art is actually the easy part, but then the fun part, but then the business part is like, you know, looking at your inbox, editing. Like my Japanese people are always asking me to send this over, edit this, do that. And then you got to quote people, you got to follow up, you got to invoice, you got to coming up with the ideas to paint, you have a brief, maybe you're applying for mural jobs, you got to fill out the paperwork. You got to pay your bills. You got to do your accounting. I probably do too much stuff. I probably should outsource a bit more, but I still do my own bookkeeping.
Yeah.
Got a good program.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not fun. I often dream about having like someone do all that for me, but then you got to pay them and I'm too stingy to do that. So I don't know.
Oh, bro. That Naval guy says, if it ain't creative, outsource it, brother.
I'm actually listening to his audio book.
Yeah. Get someone else to do the heavy lifting for you, dude.
Yeah, I'm just like super bad at I guess I'm just like super busy making artworks and like doing all these commissions that I don't have any time to spend on the business and run it like a business. I've been thinking about this for years. I just think about this and just like get frustrated, but then I never do anything about it. I just keep saying yes to what pops into my inbox. It's super frustrating.
So you're a bit of a yes man. So it gets you work and you get the work done, but then you just, oh, maybe we should think about tightening the screws a bit, but don't come to me, man.
Yeah, I definitely need to work on this business way more. Like, yeah, need a business coach or something. I actually know the things that I'm meant to be doing, but then it's easy knowing what you're meant to do, but it's hard actually doing it. You know, you got to sit down. It's not fun. I don't know.
But the world keeps spinning, bro, and you just keep painting, I guess, man. But that's a good thing.
Yeah, just keep bumbling along.
What are some of the favorite jobs that you've done? Give us, what do you reckon? You would have done a bloody hundreds by now, but like, what are some of your favorites?
Yeah, I like working with big brands because you kind of get more exposure and like more people discover your art. So we did some stuff with Coca-Cola.
Oh yeah,
that was pretty cool. I did some artworks with them. Then they painted murals in different cities. I think Brisbane, Melbourne, Sydney, but I didn't actually paint the artworks. There's like a professional mural painting company that like paints billboards.
Yeah.
So they kind of painted my artworks up and signed my name. So that was pretty cool. I got paid to not do the paintings, but they had the artwork of the King's Cross
next where to the that Coca-Cola sign is. That was pretty wild. Spot. Yeah. One of those moments where you're like, damn. That's pretty cool. Like you're saying, like those kind of I made it moments.
Yeah, it was super cool.
That's a pretty iconic spot.
It was mad. There's actually got a photo because it was like the image I had was just like a gorilla playing the guitar and then a bearded dude with his arm around the gorilla. And it was like, it literally looked like me and my dad. So we went there and like I got a red guitar like it was in the picture, and then my dad's standing there, he looks like a gorilla.
He does look like a gorilla.
Wearing no shirt, holding a Coke. We kind of recreated the artwork. It was classic.
Oh, that's so nice. I'd love to see that photo, dude.
It's on Instagram somewhere.
Or maybe just Google
Mulga Coca-Cola sign. It might pop up in the Google search.
Oh, that is so hectic. Have you had many of those moments along your way where you're just kind of, you're so in your process, just painting, working, doing that, but then you kind of have those step back moments where you look at it and you're like, whoa, I'm making some good ground here, or like I'm making some change. Was that one of them? Do you have any others like that?
I remember early on, like before 2012, I got an email from a rapper from his management. Oh, forget his name. Yeah. And the job never ended up happening. They want to do a Skype. I never did it. I always miss out on these opportunities. Like when you get some like more famous, bigger people, like contact you about opportunities. Yeah. I've literally blown them every time. Like I wrote a kid's book.
Yeah.
Mulga's Magical Musical Creatures. And then I actually got connected on Twitter with Jermaine from Flight of the Conchords.
Yeah.
He's like in all these animated movies. He's in like The Muppets. He's in like Rio, does like the voiceovers. He's like legit dude.
Yeah.
And then he bought a jumper from somewhere that had my art on it. And then I like chatted to him like, oh yeah, could you like narrate my book? Like just read it and I'll make a little video with your voice. And he was like, he actually called me up on the phone, Jermaine. He called me up and I had a chat to him. He's like, he was just in the middle of doing his, what is it? It's a TV show about vampires, a movie. Awesome show. He was in the middle of doing that. He said, oh, he's pretty busy. And I never followed him up. So it never happened. So I blew it.
are comms your strong point, dude?
Not really.
No. It's sometimes like that, bro. Especially like these days, you've got to be so on your phone and like hitting back people and remembering and stuff. Like, it's hard.
Yeah, I'm usually used to the one people follow chasing me up, so I'm not good at chasing other people up that are like bigger fish than me. I always just blow it.
Yeah. Oh, you're living.
I'm like, damn it, that was a great opportunity, and I missed it. Damn. But I never seem to learn, so I don't know.
I don't know, man. Maybe it's not meant to be, dude.
Yeah, true. Sometimes, yeah, it's not meant to be. Yeah, who knows?
I actually had a little quote, like, I don't know, an idea run past this. Now, Joel's younger brother, Eden, paints. He's got like a pretty similar style to you. Almost what I would call like the brother of your art, quite literally. Obviously, you guys are brothers. Have you ever thought about how like paint, like hereditary painting is in that sense? Like, it's literally, you look at them, the way you use both your colors is so similar. And yeah, it's like, and these kind of characters and patterns, like, do you reckon it's been inspired from you? Is this both coming out of your brains and your DNA?
We both use Posca paint pens, so they have a limited color range. So that's part of why the colors are similar.
It's more just the brightness.
Yeah, I guess, you know, if you have similar tastes, so he has a taste in art that's similar to mine, then our artworks are going to be similar. But yeah, I'm influenced by heaps of different artists. You know, you just see something, you're like, that's awesome. I like how they've done that. I'm going to apply that into my art. That's just kind of how everyone does it. Everyone copied everyone.
Yeah.
So yeah, if it's your brother doing your art, yeah, doing art, you might be influenced by certain things. But yeah, he's definitely not copying me. Like, he's got his own style.
No, I don't think he's copying you. Definitely not. It's just such a similar style, but like different.
Yeah, it's just kind of. Yeah, I guess it comes from your personality. If you're kind of if we're both a bit quirky and weird, and you've got a similar sense of humor, then yeah, that's going to come through. So yeah, I think it is, like, you know, family. You got similar upbringing, you know, literally identical upbringing because we're brothers. So yeah, it all kind of.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. Related. It's just cool to see, man. Who are some of your art inspos for you? And do they continue to inspire you?
Not so much anymore. I think when you're developing your style and trying to figure out, you know, what you do as an artist, and you're kind of looking around for inspiration, but not so much anymore. But yeah, Henry Rosso, he's like a French painter dude who's around like Salvador Dali and Picasso. I think they kind of discovered him a bit.
Yeah.
But he's just like these crazy jungle paintings. They're like super cool. You need to look him up. Henry Rosso, Henry with an I.
Dude, so I honestly do think you're like a businessman as much as an artist. So what advice would you have for an aspiring artist, you know, coming up? And I suppose you do talk to a lot of them. What kind of advice do you give them if they're asking?
Yep. I would say there's heaps of books on being an artist and making a living from your art. Go read 10 books. You're going to get so many ideas from like people that have done it, people that have spent 5 years of their life writing this book with all the best advice. They talk to people. I'd say do that, and that'd be, you know, heaps of advice, better advice than I could give you. But what else? Yeah, if you're going to make an artwork, just think what's the end result. If you want to sell your art and make it your side hustle or make it your full-time hustle, you got to think about how that's going to happen. But most of all, just develop your art, experiment, get a really cool, unique style. That's super hard to do. Just means doing lots of art and
figuring it out.
Just trying to get better. Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
I don't know. There's so much advice, business advice.
Oh, where do you start, dude? Best bit of
advice. You can hang around people that are successful, you know. So people hang around, come and help me paint murals, and then, yeah, I'll give them advice and they'll become more successful, you know. You become who you hang around with, so.
Yeah.
Find 100%. Someone, yeah.
Best bit of advice you've ever received, Joel?
Yeah, I guess I just read lots of books and you just get little bits of advice here and there. Yeah, someone told me to start an Instagram account. That was pretty good. That helped.
Like, yeah, bro. That really kicked things off for me, man. Shout out to that guy, the guy that you worked with.
Matthew McKay. Thanks, Matt.
Oh, that's lovely. All right, as we get to wrap it up here, dude, what's one philosophy you like to live your life by?
Do what you say you're going to do. good in business too, you know, be reliable.
Yeah,
have a good brand, 100%. Have a good name.
Yeah. I think, yeah, do you find, like, is that one of your big kind of principles that you want to kind of work by? Because you work, like, you are a business as well as just, like, the painting. Like, and if people find out that Mulga's just a pain in the butt to work with, they won't. Is that one of
the things? Yeah, I'm super easy to work with. So if you're super easy to work with and you do what you say you're going to do, then the next time a job comes up, they'll send you another email and they'll talk to people, they'll recommend you. If you do a bad job, they're not going to recommend you. Even if you do one little thing, like you say you're going to turn up and you rock up 2 hours late and they're waiting for you, they probably won't recommend you to anyone just because of that. Even though you do an awesome painting, that little thing.
Yeah, that's just a bit like, I think, accountability, man. You've got to be onto it. I like that.
Yeah.
I think I can't remember how you worded it, the first sentence.
What was it?
Do what you say you're going to do.
Yeah. Don't be flaky, mate.
Yeah, no, you can't be, dude. What's one bit of advice you'd give to your younger self, you know, who's at the markets, still working at the full-time job, side hustling now?
Probably, like, enjoy the process. Probably enjoy the journey. I'm still giving that to myself at the moment. Just trying to, you know, enjoy it a bit more, maybe slow down a little bit, have fun along the way.
Slowing down a little bit is enjoying it a bit more, hey?
Yeah, you have goals, but you got to – most of your life is working and trying to achieve those goals, so you want to enjoy it while you're doing it. You only live once. So if you're stressing every day trying to smash a million paintings out, then you get stuff done, but you just
– stressing.
Yeah, you've had a bad time.
Yeah.
You haven't had a good time that week. Yeah.
Yeah. What are some of your goals, dude? Are you a goal setter?
Yeah, I read a book. I've read books on goal setting. In 2012, like when I did my first art show, I remember I read a book on goal setting. And then they had this thing where you set three goals. So there's one that's like super easy. You can pretty much do it. And then one that's pretty hard. And then one that's like super hard. So I set in 2012, my goals were like make 20 grand from my art. That was like the hard one. Make 10 grand, like the bit harder. And then 5 grand, the easy one. Pretty much that year did exactly 20 grand.
Nice. Done a bit more than that now as well.
Yeah. So, one goal is I love to live right near the beach so I can just, like, walk to the beach and go for a surf instead of driving my car. I hate hate driving through Caringbah. There's, like, so many traffic lights. It's a punish.
Yeah.
Having a beach house. That'd be sweet.
I know,
that'd
man.
Be good.
What if you just go on down to Bali, bro? We love Bali.
Yeah, Bali's good. It's good having a little house down there on the point.
Mm. That would be beautiful. Where do you see Mulga in 5 to 10 years, man?
Oh, mate, I don't even think about it. I just kind of focused on doing all the jobs I've got at the moment. I should probably do some forward planning and thinking. But hopefully, doing some more licensing. Hopefully Japan's taken off a lot more. Japan's kind of my... That's kind of my, hopefully Japan just like really takes off. So then I don't have to think about it or like try hard at it. They're the ones that are working hard. They're the ones that are planning.
Yeah.
So I'm just hoping that can like blow up. That'd be good.
That would be good.
Yeah.
All right, dog. It's been an absolute pleasure chatting with you. Lots of lols, bro. I love chatting with you, man.
It's been good, man.
I know. It's an incredible story. If anyone who probably has seen you from the start and just kind of seen what you were, like not that, I don't know, just a small account to this kind of just big street artist and you're just everywhere on everything. And the kind of brands you've worked with along the way is pretty incredible. So it's a testament to you to kind of chasing your dreams and, I don't know, looking for something to like make your real hustle. It's pretty epic, man.
Yeah, it's been good. I've been very blessed, very fortunate. Yeah, life's been good.
Happy days, bro. Thank you for jumping on the seaside. I hope you all enjoyed this, Motorinos. You're with here with Mulga or Joel Moore, one of the great sexy Moors. Aren't we? Bloody hell, it's good stuff. But, been an awesome chat. We thank you a lot, and we'll chat to you all soon.
Everybody's going to the party. Have a real good time.
Yup, you know we are.
That's the wrong button.
In the desert, blowing up the sunshine.